So good morning, Nathan Lester. It's been 151 days now. 151 days that LaMelo Parker was killed. A three-month-old child gone in a hail of bullets from law enforcement. And we still don't know which one of those bullets landed in the back and tiny body of LaMelo Parker. Right now it's being investigated by the Biloxi PD, and they are trying to do a thorough job based on the information that they received from other agencies. The other agencies involved in that shooting was the Gulfport PD, Harrison County Sheriff, and of course state troopers. We were anticipating information about a month ago, actually. And obviously, the information we received that it would be imminent was wrong. And it could very well be. We'll give the benefit of the doubt. Maybe there was some new information coming from the FBI. The FBI is looking into the ballistics part. They have not taken over the investigation as of yet. However, I can tell you that there is some interest by the Justice Department in this case, primarily because the rights of one LaMelo Parker was, in fact, taken away, either by law enforcement or by the person we call his father, loosely. And that was Smith, who was driving the car. We will keep you posted, but for it to be 151 days now and still no resolution to this investigation is quite pathetic. Quite. Especially when we've seen so many other cases that were not police involved, that seemingly were pursued a little bit more vigorously in investigation. But we'll be patient. I'm not going anywhere. The family of LaMelo's not going anywhere either. And they stand with us. And we know you do too. So the rise of the Moors are in the news. The blackout still continues, primarily because the rise of the Moors are in fact incarcerated, all 10 of them. The sole juvenile is not incarcerated. I understand that row 3 of them are going to be arraigned today.
3 will be getting their arraignments there today, yeah.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand what they arraigned on. You've got the charges here, and
and a lot of these are just holdovers from that initial arraignment that went on for so long back in July 7th, where there was multiple disruptions and whatnot. So a lot of these arraignments...
Well, there's some contempt charges there.
And contempt like. Charges, right. Mm-hmm. But a lot of these arraignments are just following up. Here's the latest from that area.
Well, the last time the members of the Rise of the Moors were in court, it was a bizarre couple of days as they believe that they are sovereign citizens and U.S. law does not apply to them. Now, the reason they are in court stems to early July. Police arrested 11 men after a standoff on 95 North in Wakefield that shut down the highway for hours. Officers say the men were heavily armed and they said they were on their way from Rhode Island to Maine for tactical training. Now, at their initial arraignments in district court, proceedings that usually take just a few minutes took hours. They were marked by outbursts, and there was an increased security around the courthouse as well. So now 8 of the men will face charges in Superior Court. A grand jury indicted them on numerous gun charges, including having a large capacity weapon and wearing body armor during a felony. None of the men had gun licenses, and several of the men are also charged with giving police false names. Now, these men are from New York, Rhode Island, and Michigan. Some will appear before the judge on Zoom and others in person. Reporting live at Superior Court in Woburn, Katie Brace, NBC 10 Boston.
This is probably one of the most serious cases for the Second Amendment debate. And we're the only ones talking about it. Now, you got to understand, ladies and gentlemen, these 11 were on their way to Maine to train. They considered themselves a militia. They were on interstate highway. They pulled over on the interstate highway in Massachusetts, where they began to fill up with gas. This was in and around the 4th of July. And obviously, a lot of us were concerned. There were some Homeland Security had issued out some warnings that potentially something could happen around the 4th. Particularly around this highway. I think it's Interstate 95 somewhere in and around there. So these guys pulled over to gas up. They had gas cans in their vehicles, and they were intent on not getting off the interstate. They want to stay on the interstate, gas up along the way. And then, of course, an officer, state trooper, came along, noticed that they were there early morning hours, and stopped to pull over to see if he can offer some assistance, and noticed then that they were heavily armed, and some of the weapons seemingly did not meet the laws of Massachusetts. Now, that's where this went south. You see, in Massachusetts, for instance, you can't have a clip longer than 10 rounds in a clip. And of course, there's some licensing requirements. And so the state trooper called in for backup and wanting to get more information on the individuals he was with, and a standoff began. Well, it's not a good thing. They even called in a special weapon. What was that, the sound device, bro? What do they call that thing again? The LA something? Where they make screeching sounds to try and get the rise of the Moors from the tree line.
Right, the LRAD, high-pitched audible alarm system.
Yeah. And they were charged. They were charged with unlawful possession of a firearm, improper storage of firearms around a minor, wearing body armor during a felony, conspiracy to possess firearms, possession of a loaded firearm, possession of ammunition. The list kind of goes on and on, not giving someone convicted, well, not convicted, but charged with not giving proper ID, proper name. And they've chosen to stay in jail. Well, I take that back. They were not offered bond, and they have chosen not to have a defense attorney appointed, although the judge has a defense attorney as an advisor. A gentleman by the name of Bay, former Marine, actually, is actually playing the part of the attorney for Rise of the Moors, and he too is incarcerated, you see. This is an incredible case. I don't know what's going to happen out of this. About a week ago, some women affiliated with Rise of the Moors were arrested outside the courthouse, some of which had firearms in the car. We don't have any details on that disposition, do we?
No further details, no, sir.
Now, folks, look, I'm watching this because no one else is, and until such time that there is something heinous happens, either the Rise of the Moors go on a rampage, whatever, make a break for it. I would hope that would not be the case. I would hope that Bay, the leader of them, will understand that this case is very, very crucial to the Second Amendment rights, period. I resent hearing the announcer say that they consider themselves sovereign citizens. I want you to pull up Bay and his dissertation about that.
Well, I wanted to, because we heard Bay do it initially, but we heard it again from possibly one of those women who was arrested. I believe it was Bay's wife or fiance. But I want to go back to that initial court appearance, because what you just said rings true again. But my question to you is, are they treating it like it is as important as it is? This is that initial court appearance, how that went, and then you'll hear them refute the claim that they are sovereign citizens.
Accompanied by a full state police motorcade, 10 members of the Rise of the Moors appearing in court.
You can watch the proceedings by video conference.
The arraignments are full of outbursts.
I am three more.
Courtroom yelling.
People, out of it.
And several Zoom bombs.
High treason.
We're located on I-95 North in the colony of Massachusetts.
In all, 10 men and a juvenile were arrested Saturday morning after an hours-long standoff on state police said the 11, who said they claimed they adhere to the Moorish sovereign ideology, were heavily armed. and claimed they were traveling from Rhode Island to Maine for, quote, training.
We are not sovereign citizens. Absolutely not. We are not sovereign citizens.
Outside court, supporters of the men gathered.
All we do is buy books, research the law, and help uplift humanity.
I'm going to ask you not to interrupt me again.
Back inside court, a usually quick legal procedure dragged on for hours. Many of the suspects made it clear they wish to represent themselves or have one of their co-defendants represent them.
To my knowledge, your co-defendant is not a licensed attorney.
NBC 10 Boston's legal analyst Michael Coyne says the judge did the best she could, keeping order during the most unusual day.
The old adage, an individual who represents themselves as a fool for a client, is still true today.
And as you saw right there, with everything that happened, they actually ran out of time. Two more defendants will be arraigned, identified the identity of that 10th man. We are told all 10 also face the possibility of federal charges. By the Medford, Eli Rosenberg, NBC 10 Boston.
Yeah. Shirley was in.
All right, folks, you need to watch this very closely. I have a very, very bad feeling about this. I think the young men have a very good case, but they're not executing it well. And they're prosecuting. They're being prosecuted. In some cases, I would say persecuted. Because what they did is what any of us who have firearms will do. I mean, I don't mind telling you, I've traveled all around this country, and I never once think to look at the difference in the gun laws. Even in Chicago, and I know Chicago's gun laws are different from those in Mississippi. Have I one time taken a firearm into Chicago? Yes. On interstate highway. I've not been stopped. But this is curious, Ro.
Yeah.
However, they are not executing this well.
Yeah, my thoughts exactly.
Now, you know, it harkens back to the young man who left college and decided to go to a McCory's, you know, back during the days of segregation when they came in and sat at the stools on the white section and were arrested. And they opted to stay in jail. They did. They did not post-bond, these young college students. And you got to understand, this is the height of the Vietnam conflict. And when you did something like this, if you were not in school, then you or 4F, then you were on your way to Saigon. But they took that chance and they stole toast, decided to stay in bail. I mean, to stay in jail and no bail. Stay in jail, no bail, right? And they did it for a reason, to dramatize the ridiculousness of them being arrested. And in that case, persecuted. Now, maybe that's the case here, but you know, the only problem I have here is that there was outside advice given to those students. They chose to stay in jail, but they did have representation.
They did not attempt to represent themselves.
There you go. In other words, someone can offer you, if you don't pay bail, then a judge can say, okay, so I'll let you out on your own recognizance. They did not do that. Said, no, we're not bailing out. We're not going to pay bail. They're going to stay in to show the ridiculousness of all of this. And it was smart. It worked then. But it worked because there was, in fact, when they were arraigned, they were represented by an attorney, and therefore they ended up with a case that can be taken to the Supreme Court. You got me? That's what justice happens. It's not going to happen in the jail. You might get some sympathy, empathy there from some. Or it might further show how the ridiculousness of a wrong law or behavior on the part of law enforcement, one can argue. But they got to have representation, though, and they're refusing representation, and that's not good. It's not good at all. Because I can see where this, they can very well be railroaded, and in some cases, I mean, you realize, ladies and gentlemen, every time there's an outburst and someone and a judge holds you in contempt, you realize that's time. Yeah. I mean, that shows that you are being rambunctious. That shows that you're being defiant. However, I don't know why the news media keeps saying that they are sovereign citizens. When, I mean, even Bay himself said, no, we're going by the Constitution.
Yeah.
And he is. He cited the code. And the Constitution does say that, you know, notwithstanding some state laws, you have the right to keep and bear arms and carry your firearms intrastate. So, we'll keep you posted. So, the arraignment's going on today. Let's see how that goes. I want you to monitor that. We'll let you know. No one else is doing this. Folks, there's a... do we have a local story on it? There in Boston, see if do you have a local story. Do you have one?
Just had snippet that I played before.
That's it? That's all you got, just a local story. I mean, there is literally a blackout on this. Of course, now the 10 are filing suit in federal court, civil suit. They're suing everybody involved for depriving them of their rights and defamation. Defamation, discrimination of national origin, and deprivation of their rights under the color of law, which means that they're being treated unfairly by law enforcement. It's a good argument. They're asking for $70 million in damages. Of course, they've already had one case that was dismissed. And this will possibly be dismissed as well, unfortunately, because Bay is writing it while he is incarcerated. And he isn't an attorney. And there's some time considerations here.
Do you think that even if they had someone outside as legal counsel, even if Bay's still calling the shots, but if they had a legit co-counsel, that it would serve them better?
Yes. Yeah, you see, what's got to happen is, I mean, the procedures here is what he's missing. He doesn't know decorum as far as when to file, how to file. He's reading this. It's on the job training for him. You got me? You cannot deal with a case this high profile this way. You just can't. You've gotta have someone who knows the legalese and so forth to be able to. Get this down. Bro, you need to check this, if you will. This is Comrade. So, we'll keep you posted here, folks. We will. We'll be the only ones to keep you posted. Because, I can tell you right now, if there was any validity to so-called Second Amendment writers, so-called conservative Second Amendment Bible thumpers, they'd be all over this. They would be all over this. Because this case right here is a serious case. This case is going to determine whether or not, you know, whether there are some protections for those of us who are Second Amendment supporters. All right, 228-896-9455. I've got one question only here, and that is about the vaccination. But before we do, I want to get Fat in if I can. Where are you, Fat, right here? Good morning, Fat. How you doing, brother?
Come on, Richard. Richard, you recall the time back when the Nissan San Diego and Jackson is in operation, not back when the Muslims wanted to set up their own territory back there to grow their own crops and everything, perform their own government. You remember that kind of that situation that happened way back about 72, 73?
So you're talking about when the African organization, of which Lumumba was a part.
Yeah.
And before they had the firing on Jackson State, when the young man was...
Right.
Yeah.
But now, these young men, they want to go for militia training. Now, how many times in Georgia and South Carolina have these people been questioning everything about transporting the militia training camp? They're all over Georgia, South Carolina. Right, there's some sites on television where, like, they're asking for militia people to come into, to be trained.
Yeah.
You know, these weapons that these people have, a lot of that stuff comes from police, from the police department, you know, all over the United States. I wonder how you got that weapon there.
Well, I mean, the thing is, in Rhode Island, I mean, it's not illegal, the weapons that they have. But in Massachusetts, it is. And they were driving through Massachusetts. Yeah. And so therein lies the problem. The question is whether or not they have to adjust to Massachusetts law. If you're carrying a firearm with more than 10 clips, and you're on the highway on your way, you know, to another state, New York or wherever, do you have to now? What do you do with your weapons? What do you do with your clip? Of course, obviously meaning the state troopers can't arbitrarily stop you. I mean, but if there is, or they, if they're looking for someone, let's say that there's a roadblock and they're looking for someone, and here you are coming along with a clip that has 30 rounds in it. So what do they do? Do they say, okay, well, you're coming through Massachusetts and the clip's too large, so therefore you got to be arrested? I don't think that's I don't think that's the intent of the federal code.
Yeah.
All right, Fat, appreciate it. What was that?
Okay.
What was that, Fat? I'm sorry.
I wonder how these weapons being transported to South Carolina and Georgia. I mean, they pick out the states that they gonna cross with their weapons, because they have tanks, they have those anti-SWAT team and stuff that they're taking to the militia camp, 50 caliber machine guns built, and these things coming from the cyber acts coming from the police department when they buy new weapons. The government's, you know, giving these weapons to these militia. There has to be some law against that. I don't know what it is. There has to be some law against that.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, I don't know. Yeah, I appreciate it, Pat. I don't know if they're giving them away. I mean, you can buy a 50 caliber. Now, you can't buy a 50 caliber automatic machine gun, as it's called. But anyway, I will keep you posted, folks. I've reached out to some associates of mine there in Boston. And, you know, the problem is that the Rise of the Moors are not doing a very good job of creating allies. You know, you've got to reach beyond the jail in a situation like this. You really do. You can't just what is that? There was a movie done on Netflix about this, the Chicago 7, I think it was.
The trial of Chicago 7.
Yeah. And there's a similar situation here. Of course, these guys were not militia. They were protesting students and so forth.
Yeah.
And you had one member of the Black Panther Party,
Bobby Seale, for
defense, Bobby Seale, that's correct, and he was giving some outbursts and so forth, and being defiant, because he knew the law, he did, but the reality here is that you don't just have the law, there's parliamentary procedures, there is court decorum that you've got to maintain, or else, you know, you can be bound and gagged, as was one Bobby Seale. I mean, if you want to put on a presentation, or if you want to draw attention to yourself, I get that, but there's got to be a reason. Your audience has to be an audience that is going to thereby then react positively for you and not negatively.
Yeah.
You got me? You got to know who your audience is. Can I get Renee in? Renee, good morning. Hello, is this Renee? Is it Mr. or Miss Renee?
Mr.
Renee. Renee, sorry about that. Must have us on hold. We'll go back to you. All right, here's my question, folks. What are we going to do about this vaccine? In some areas, vaccines are required. Not vaccines and or testing, but just vaccines. New York right now is dealing with that. The NBA is dealing with that. And even right here close to home, any business that has over 100 employees, you've got to have vaccination or testing. But in some cases, like for instance at one of the local casinos, it's vaccinations.
Yeah.
There are a few exceptions, and then you can have some tests. Because there are some individuals who, just physically, and their doctors don't advise that they get a vaccination. There are some circumstances like that. We thought we had one of those individuals here in the office, but we don't, as we found out. In some cases, there are some people who are on some very powerful medications, and so therefore the vaccination, which vaccination, I don't know, for whatever reason, that's not a good idea, for fear of some reaction. So there are some exceptions, all right? But then there are those individuals, and we got into this yesterday, and I really want to have a healthy, good discussion about it. I really do, folks. Look, I'm going to go on the record. I'm only 2 months out from getting my Johnson & Johnson's vaccine. It took that long because I was basically investigating. I was leery. You see, you know, I had to gauge what was best for me being a healthy young man, but at an age where, that could count against me. And I feel even to this day that, okay, if I were to get COVID, I'll survive it. I don't think I'll be taken out, but I don't believe anything will take me out, to be quite frank. I just don't. And I do believe in the natural process of things. I've never gotten a flu shot. I don't want to get the flu, but I felt I can survive the flu and therefore build up some antibodies to fight the next flu. I mean, it was a natural thing to get a cold and so forth, and you go through it 2-3 days and maybe 5 or 6 days with the flu. But now this COVID thing's a different thing altogether, and I've got plenty of evidence in my family. So when I saw my son go through 2 weeks and he was sick, not deathly ill, but too sick for me to be thinking, I'll ride that one out. I didn't want to ride that out, so I had to gauge. Well, okay, so if the vaccine is some kind of crazy, so I end up being a zombie, all right. You know, is it zombie tomorrow and be on a ventilator today? That's your choice. You want to think that you're going to be a robot? Okay, so is a robot tomorrow or a ventilator today? What's the possibilities?
Robot or cyborg.
Or a cyborg or whatever. You know, that had nothing to do with my decision. It has to do with the science that I'm seeing where people are faring better. Who had the vaccine? They didn't get it sick. Has there been a one or two to die? Well, yeah, maybe. And so I had to make that decision. So I made the decision. Now, here's the question. How important is that decision to you? In other words, is it important enough for you to keep your job? Right now, a judge has ruled that in New York City that that healthcare workers are going to have to be vaccinated. And if they're not, then they can be suspended and or fired. And some are on a timetable. And then there's the NBA. I want you to listen to what is being said now between, Irving? Kyrie Irving and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Let's start with Kyrie Irving, and he was asked about whether or not he's vaccinated. And listen to his position.
First, and obviously living in this public sphere, it's just a lot of questions about what's going on in, you know, in the world of Kyrie, and I think I just would love to just keep that private and handle it the right way with my team and go forward together with a plan. So, you know, obviously I'm not able to be present there today, but it doesn't mean that I'm putting any limits on the future of me being able to join the team. And I just want to keep it that way so we can keep that private. And if anybody has any further questions about that, please, it'd be the same response. I would like to keep that private. And just please respect that.
I understand you want to keep this private, and I do think there's, you know, people should have privacy to a certain extent, but people are speculating about certain stances you have and that you're not going to be available to your team and that kind of thing. And just why don't you want to clear that up to some extent?
Yeah, please respect my privacy. Next question.
You know.
As in fans too? They also want to know, not just us.
Yeah, next question.
You know, I really have a lot of respect for ball players and so forth, but they are a little bit spoiled. I mean, you got to keep in mind it starts in high school and then college. They are insulated, and in some cases they feel that that they're beyond the public or who else. In other words, let me put this: the arrogance in some cases is more. It's too prevailing. I first saw that actually with what is his name? He was Bill Russell, and his counterpart there was a tall guy, big guy. Oh, it'll come to me. But he was the same way. They're kind of pampered, and does he have privacy? Yeah, but when you're in public life, you have no private life. You might think you do, but you know you're owned by the NBA. Now don't get me wrong, you don't have to be owned. Then what you need to do is go into private practice. You know, you have to realize that. Now you have to make some choices. Now if you're gonna go into Brooklyn, you gotta be vaccinated. It will not be private. It won't be private. Now you might tell that to the commentators or the news people or the sports people, but the reality is that you won't be playing. Either you are or you're not. And so you have a decision to make. Can it be private? Yeah, it can be. In other words,
was that Will Chamberlain?
Wilt Chamberlain. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And he was like this. And look, I know, it's one thing to say I'm not going to give out my home address or my children's name and so forth. You know, but whether or not you're vaccinated, which means that you will qualify to play, is a pretty important question, right? I mean, it goes way beyond you, too, by the way, just for those of you who don't know it. It goes to those individuals who could be around you and what they can catch from you. You do realize that I can get secondhand COVID like I can get secondhand smoke. So I keep bringing it up, and you guys don't. There are some who hate that I bring it up. But the same minority who was fighting against smoking, and I was a smoker, by the way, the same minority who was jumping up and down, but they became smaller and smaller and smaller because the number of those who were non-smokers and who did not want to get secondhand smoke, lung disease, they weren't loud. They were like, okay, yeah, well, we just won't be around you. And that's what resulted in those little smoky glass rooms with the face pressed against the window and cigarettes hanging out of their mouth. Look, I can't knock it. I want to smoke every day, really, with my coffee, but I just assume lick an ashtray. But the point here is that with Irving, I say to myself, you got to decide. You want to play ball or not? You know, I had to decide whether I wanted to fly or not. Or whether I wanted to go some other places or not when I was not vaccinated. It wasn't like I was whining, what about my rights? Well, the sign says vaccinated only. Okay, I'm not. All right. Well, I just made that decision. The government didn't make that decision for me. I made that decision. I made a decision that, I'm not going to get on the Delta flight. So I missed an opportunity. Boo-hoo! It's my fault. We'll be back.
What's up? This is Riley. And a little thing I love about the Chick-fil-A grilled chicken club sandwich is the applewood bacon. It's savory.